Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Science of Science Fiction, The Influence of Film and Fiction on the Science and Culture of Our Times, by Mark Brake. Narrated by Matt Godfrey. Pythagoras, with the looking glass, reflects the full moon. In blood, he's writing the lyrics of a brand new tune. Genesis. Introduction. Here's a true story about my own science fiction past. When I was a kid, I used to fill my days by reading lots of futuristic science fiction stories. Stories about space, tales about time travel, entertaining yarns about gadgets and inventions, and comic book accounts of the superpowers we might one day possess. The influence of these stories on my friends and me was simply huge. It occupied our waking hours as well as our dreams. It gifted us fevered and fertile imaginations. My friend Zap shared this fertile imagination, fed and fueled by science fiction. In fact, our imaginations became so fevered that one day, Zap managed to convince me and some other friends that we could become superheroes. How would such superhero status be achieved? Simply by necking, that's local slang for drinking, some super serum made by Zap's own fair hand. Yes, we must have been sweetly innocent or stupid to believe this fable and fabric of nonsense straight out of the comic books, channeled through Zap's imagination and back out into the real world. We waited and waited for the big day when our transformation from boy into superboy would come. We grew impatient. But Zap, when are we going to become superheroes? We justifiably asked. Don't worry about that, dudes. I've got it covered. I'm making some super serum in my dad's crib. Yes, super serum. In his dad's crib. On a housing project in Britain back in those swinging 60s. Sure, Stan Lee's Marvel superhero tales in the 1960s were all about ordinary folk like us. Stan had revolutionized the genre with a large dose of reality. Down-to-earth characters living everyday lives with stories peopled by folk who had personal problems. But super serum? In his dad's crib on a housing project? It would have been wise to question the validity of Zap's claims. But wise we were not, as Yoda might chime. We were far too distracted by the promise of all the trappings superhero-dom brings. Jumping over buildings, stopping speeding bullets, and of course, the girls. We got tired of waiting. Zap kept on promising, but nothing was delivered. In the end, we simply demanded the super serum, at once, with no delay, now. We demanded the ability to jump over buildings, to stop speeding bullets, and of course, we demanded the girls. We followed Zap home and impatiently waited outside his house until he brought forth the super serum. In comics, inventors often appear to bring forth the invention. As Zap triumphantly came out of the lab, his dad's crib, our breath was fully bated. What was he carrying, you may wonder? A sleek test tube full of some fluorescent and clearly cosmic super serum worthy of Hugo Strange? Perhaps a wizard potion in a cool Professor Snape-ish vial? Or a huge syringe with which to transform us forever? No. Zap came out of his house with nothing more than a bowl full of ordinary water. Gutted. In fact, mega eviscerated. Picture this. My friends and I in a towering Hulk-like rage, reaching almost superhero proportions without the help of a super serum. After all that waiting, we were incensed. We were severely disappointed. We were incandescent. We hurled the bowl of water over Zap's head and stormed off into the sunset. Disillusioned, but determined to find a brighter future. A science fiction world. Maybe my early super serum experience is the main reason why, ever since, I've gotten a huge buzz on hearing that one of the predictions I read about as a kid has actually turned out to be true. If you've lived the dream from the start and see the idea turn into reality, it can be simply inspiring. It very much depends on perspective, though. Take this example. I was recently blown away by the fact that, sitting in a greasy British cafe, I was still able to watch a live soccer match on my phone. I was suitably enthusiastic to my kids. "Look, kids, I'm watching the football. It's the future. It's science fiction," I said. My kids were totes unfazed. "No, Dad, it's just a smartphone." And yet, years before, I'd already found my niche as a professor of science communication at a British university, where I'd invented study courses that focused on the future. One course was all about the search for alien life in space, and another was all about the links between science and science fiction. But the one thing they had in common was our future on Earth and in space. As a university science professor, I also did some writing for NASA and organized speaking tours for Russian cosmonauts, pioneers of space travel. Through my work, I found that humans have been making up science fiction stories for hundreds of years, much longer than you'd think. Some of the earliest stories were about space voyages. They're in this book. They come from a time, the early 1600s, when astronomers had found that the Earth was in orbit around the sun and not the other way around. Ships had started voyaging around the globe 400 years ago, so writers had already started to imagine sailing out into space. Since then, there have been thousands of amazing science fiction stories about aliens and time machines, spaceships and cyborgs, androids and the end of the world. These stories all have one thing in common. They're about the way science may affect our lives in the future. So it should be no surprise that this book is about the future. We are the first generation to live in a science fiction world. Media headlines declare this the age of automation. The TV talks about the coming revolution of the robot. Tweets tell tales of jets that will ferry travelers to the edge of space. And social media reports that the first human to live for 1,000 years has already been born. The science we do, the movies we watch, and the culture we consume is the stuff of fiction that became fact. The future, imagined in our past, the future we now inhabit. This book is the story of how science fiction shaped our world. No longer a subculture, science fiction has moved into the mainstream with the advent of the information age it helped realize. Explore how science fiction has driven science. This book will open your eyes to the way science fiction helped us dream of things to come, forced us to uncover the nature and limits of our own reality, and helped us build the science fiction-driven world we live in today. Part 1. Space. It's where no one can hear you scream, in Ridley Scott's Alien. It's the final frontier, in Star Trek. It's the realm of Pandora in James Cameron's Avatar, along with a billion other habitable worlds of the imagination. The science fiction of space focuses on some facet of the natural world. Very often, the space theme is about the outward human urge to conquer and master the vast interstellar depths of the cosmos, in the classic manner of Captain Kirk, and the legions of fleet and nimble ships of Star Wars and other space operas. In other tales, space is the vast, cold, and unsympathetic theater featured in Alien, or the immense void in Interstellar, a cosmos we may never come to terms with. The sheer indifference of space, such as featured in The Martian, reminds us that life may be frail and precious, but also tenacious, and that the universe is largely inhuman and deserted. That Shakespeare of science fiction, H.G. Wells, really started something with the War of the Worlds back at the end of the 19th century. Wells's Martians were an early warning of what was to come. They were the first agents of the void, the first menace from space. The Martians were Wells's timely reminder that we may not be at the top of the universe's evolutionary ladder. The alien is one of science fiction's greatest inventions. The alien is featured here in the space theme rather than monster theme for two reasons. For one, science fiction very often portrays the alien, such as the Na'vi in Avatar or the heptapods in Arrival, as animated versions of nature. Second, the monster theme in science fiction focuses on the human condition, and as we shall see, it's about the monster within us, not without. A lot of science fiction stories about space can be understood as a longing to escape our sense of being merely human. Earth is our prison. That's why we get tales in which the wonders and potential terrors of the universe are explored through the marvels of space travel, bringing tales of contact with extraterrestrial beings. Indeed, space stories have often been extrapolations of travelers' tales to lost or forgotten lands on Earth. The space theme shows us that there are great similarities between science fiction and science, and that science fiction has been a huge influence on modern science and culture. Science fiction is an imaginative device for a kind of theoretical science, the exploration of imagined worlds. Scientists build models of hypothetical worlds and then test their theories. Albert Einstein was famous for this. His Gedanken experiment, or thought experiments, led to his theory of special relativity, for example. The science fiction writer also explores hypothetical worlds, but with more scope. Scientists are meant to stay within bounded laws. Science fiction has no such boundaries. However, we can see that a spirit of what if is common to both science and science fiction. There are many examples where science fiction has proposed theories far too speculative for the science of the day, but that have later proved to be prophetic. The theme of space contains some great examples. Space travel, exoplanets, men on the moon, to name just a few. However, it's important to remember that the correctness of the science is not as important as its poetry, or the sense of wonder and adventure experienced in pursuit of the science itself. One of the best examples of the symbiosis of science and science fiction to be found anywhere is the question of life in space, or astrobiology. Through most of its history, science fiction has held a positive view of the possibility of alien life. Much of hard science fiction is made up mostly of two main sciences, physics and biology. Historically, physics came a lot earlier. Nicholas Copernicus shifted the center of the universe from the Earth to the Sun way back in 1543. Just over a century later, Isaac Newton produced a system of the world, one of the first attempts to produce a theory of everything. As a result, early fictional accounts of alien life, from Johannes Kepler's Somnium to H.G. Wells's The War of the Worlds, were based mostly on the physics in question. Simply put, the argument was based on the idea that since there are billions of stars in the universe, there must be millions, if not billions, of planets, plenty of places for E.T. to live. This line of reasoning is much like the principle of plenitude. Everything that can happen will happen. And in a universe fit for life, many planets will bear bug-eyed monsters. For a long time, the mere physics of the matter has been fiction's main concern. Biology didn't come into it. The fact of the sheer number of stars and orbiting planets was enough to suggest that life on other Earths lay waiting in the vastness of deep space. The influence was fed back into science, so that by the 20th century, an entire generation of scientists was cast under the same spell. And huge investments were made in serious searches for alien life. Meanwhile, a unified theory of biology didn't see the light of day until the second half of the 20th century. It brought a modern synthesis of aspects of biology and was accepted by the great majority of working biologists. This evolutionary synthesis provided a new perspective on the question of ET. Biologists are far more skeptical about the possibility of complex alien life, let alone intelligence. We may, they concluded, be alone in the universe after all. So let's venture into the space theme of science fiction to meet lost worlds and quantum universes, other Earths, and the human future in the cosmos. Guardians of the Galaxy. Is space full of extraterrestrials? Behind every man now alive stand 30 ghosts, for that is the ratio by which the dead outnumber the living. Since the dawn of time, roughly 100 billion human beings have walked the planet Earth. Now, this is an interesting number. For by a curious coincidence, there are approximately 100 billion stars in our local universe, the Milky Way. So, for every man who has ever lived, in this universe there shines a star. But every one of those stars is a sun, often far more brilliant and glorious than the small nearby star we call the sun. And many, perhaps most, of those alien suns have planets circling them. So almost certainly there is enough land in the sky to give every member of the human species, back to the first ape man, his own private, world-sized heaven. Or hell. How many of those potential heavens and hells are now inhabited? And by what manner of creatures? We have no way of guessing. The very nearest is a million times farther away than Mars or Venus, those still remote goals of the next generation. But the barriers of distance are crumbling. One day we shall meet our equals, or our masters, among the stars. Men have been slow to face this prospect. Some still hope that it may never become a reality. Increasing numbers, however, are asking, why have such meetings not occurred already, since we ourselves are about to venture into space? Why not, indeed? Here is one possible answer to that very reasonable question, but please remember, this is only a work of fiction. The truth, as always, will be far stranger. Arthur C. Clarke, 2001, A Space Odyssey. Yondu is floating in the air, hanging on his arrow. Peter Quill, you look like Mary Poppins. Yondu, is he cool? Peter Quill. Hell yeah, he's cool. Yondu. I'm Mary Poppins, y'all. James Gunn, Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 screenplay. The idea of a universe full of extraterrestrial life has produced many of the best movie taglines. In space, no one can hear you scream. We are not alone. A long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. The truth is out there. And of course, you only get one chance to save the galaxy twice. Science fiction writers and directors have thought long and hard about the portrayal of creatures from other worlds. The predatory and possessive mother in Ridley Scott's Alien, the swirling and sentient sea in Steven Soderbergh's Solaris, and the wise, benevolent sage with curious sentence construction in George Lucas's Star Wars series have three very contrasting extraterrestrial types. Alien as highly evolved killer, alien as ocean planet, and alien as guiding mentor, perhaps only lacking a little gravitas due to being a puppet. There are huge numbers of extraterrestrial races in the Marvel Comics universe, so much so that the Guardians of the Galaxy, a band of former intergalactic outlaws, have teamed up to protect the galaxy from planetary threats. The Galactic Council is an assembly of leaders of different alien empires from across that universe, with major races such as the Kree and the Skrulls presiding over scores of secondary alien races, mostly humanoid but occasionally weird, such as the Oskveri, a green-skinned race with octopus traits, three-toed, taloned feet, three tentacles sprouting from each shoulder rather than arms, and closely spaced needle-like teeth, which would make a mess of an intergalactic burger. But, just in case you thought this was all new, take a look at how long aliens have dwelled in the human imagination. Science fiction, driven by the discoveries of science, has been conjuring up extraterrestrials for many a moon. In fact, for much longer than you'd first imagine. Take the relationship between Italian astronomer Galileo and German math genius Johannes Kepler, for example. Moved by Galileo's discoveries with the telescope, Kepler was one of the first writers to imagine alien life. And this is in the first few years of the 1600s. Kepler made sure that the extraterrestrials stalking the characters in his proto-science fictional book, Somnium, published in 1634, were not humans. Instead, they are serpent-like creatures that are fit to survive their lunar, but quite alien, haunt. So, more than two centuries before Darwin, Johannes Kepler had been the first to grasp the bond between life forms and habitat. Science and science fiction. But, generally speaking, before science fiction really rocketed into the creative imagination in the late 19th century, extraterrestrials were not normally portrayed as genuine alien beings. They were merely seen as humans and animals living on other worlds. Charles Darwin changed all that. For Darwin essentially invented the alien. Darwin's theory of evolution gave science fiction grounds for imagining what kind of life might evolve off Earth as well as on it. From Darwin on, the notion of life beyond our home planet was linked with the physical and mental characteristics of the true extraterrestrial. And the idea of the alien became deeply embedded in the public imagination. So it's no surprise that the most credible extraterrestrials occur after his work. The archetypal alien, with its strange physiology and intellect, also owes much to H.G. Wells's first major take on Darwin, Wells's 1898 Martian invasion novel, The War of the Worlds. Wells's Martians are agents of the void. They are the brutal, natural force of evolution, and history's first menace from space. Wells's genocidal invaders, would-be colonists of planet Earth, were so influential that the alien as monster became something of a cliché in the 20th century. And the idea thrills us still. The alien as monster stalks the Nostromo in Ridley Scott's electrifying movie Alien, lies at the heart of each Dalek in Doctor Who, and briefly, to the soundtrack of ELO's Mr. Blue Sky, consumes Drax during the surreal opening title sequence of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. With advances in science, especially biology, early writers became more imaginative about alien life forms. Evolution traveled into space with the writings of French astronomer Camille Flammarion in 1872, barely a dozen years or so after Darwin published The Origin of Species. Flammarion's three Stories of Infinity were ingenious tales of an intangible alien life force. If natural selection was universal, there was no reason on Earth why the random process of evolution should merely produce humanoids on other planets. Distinguished British astronomer Fred Hoyle used his science to inspire his stories, but his fiction was not forced by his physics. Hoyle's first novel, The Black Cloud, is about a living cloud of interstellar matter. Polish science fiction writer Stanisław Lem pushed the creative imagination about alien life even further. In his famous Solaris, now an entire planet enclosed by an ocean, Solaris is portrayed as a single organism with a vast, yet strange intelligence that humans strive to understand. And then, of course, there's the depiction of the extraterrestrial as wise, benevolent teacher, here to save us from ourselves. There are the kind of aliens that show up in films such as Close Encounters of the Third Kind, where the extraterrestrials are presented as civilized and munificent aliens of superior intelligence. In the same way, aliens such as Yoda possess an almost saintly wisdom, and Marvel's Watchers are cast in a similar vein. One of the oldest species in the universe, the Watchers, are committed to watching and compiling knowledge on all aspects of life in the cosmos. But here's the point about all these different portrayals of extraterrestrial life. Even though science has made tremendous advances in the understanding of space during the 20th and 21st centuries, scientists still have relatively little to say about the psychology and physiology of the alien. That's the job of science fiction, which has been conducting a kind of continuous thought experiment on the matter for centuries. British science fiction writer Arthur C. Clarke knows all about this relationship. He stressed the influence of science fiction on the alien life debate when he said in 1968, "I have little doubt that the universe is teeming with life. The search for extraterrestrial intelligence," said he, "is now a fully accepted department of astronomy. The fact that it is still a science without a subject should be neither surprising nor disappointing. It is only within half a human lifetime that we have possessed the technology to listen to the stars." Clarke was very aware of the huge inspiration that science takes from fiction. In the history of the scientific debate on alien life, there have typically been two camps, physicists and biologists. The physical scientists, such as astronomers, have often tended toward a deterministic view of the possibility of extraterrestrial life. They focus on the physical forces in the universe and make arguments based on the sheer number of stars and orbiting planets, which they feel is somehow statistically sufficient to suggest that other Earths lie waiting in the vastness of deep space. Fiction, for many centuries, led from the front with this same argument. And since Copernicus came before Darwin, and physics before biology, fictional accounts of alien life have usually been placed firmly in the pro-SETI, pro-life camp of the alien debate. By the 20th century, an entire generation of future SETI hunters was cast under the same spell, and the imaginative power of science fiction meant that a huge investment of time and money was put into the serious scientific search for extraterrestrials. But as the 20th century progressed, the story changed. Some scientists thought we might, after all, be alone in the universe. In particular, biologists began to emphasize that while physics and fiction still think along deterministic lines, evolutionists are impressed by the incredible improbability of intelligent life ever to have evolved, even on Earth. Or, to put it in the powerful words of American anthropologist Lauren Isley, "So deep is the conviction that there must be life out there beyond the dark, one thinks that if they are more advanced than ourselves, they may come across space at any moment, perhaps in our generation." Later, contemplating the infinity of time, one wonders if perchance their messages came long ago, hurtling into the swamp muck of the steaming coal forests, the bright projectile clambered over by hissing reptiles, and the delicate instruments running mindlessly down with no report. In the nature of life and in the principles of evolution, we have had our answer. Of men elsewhere and beyond, there will be none forever. It may be tomorrow or a decade or century from now until we discover if Guardians of the Galaxy is right. The day may come when we make the most shattering discovery of all time, the discovery of a thriving extraterrestrial civilization. When our current century dawned, we'd been imagining alien life for almost 2.5 millennia, but as space agencies build flotillas of space telescopes to search for life in this unearthly universe, the crucial questions remain unanswered. The American Space Observatory Kepler, launched in 2009 to find Earth-like planets orbiting other stars, took off 400 years after Galileo's first use of the telescope, and is, of course, named after that first great Copernican theorist, Johannes Kepler. Based on Kepler's early findings, Seth Shostak, senior astronomer at the SETI Institute, estimated that within 1,000 light-years of Earth, there are at least 30,000 habitable planets. Based on the same findings, the Kepler team projected at least 50 billion planets in the Milky Way, of which at least 500 million are in the habitable zone. NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory was of a similar opinion. JPL reported an expectation of 2 billion Earth analogs in our galaxy, and noted there are around 50 billion other galaxies potentially bearing around 1 sextillion Earth analog planets. Over those last 2,500 years, a stunning array of writers and scholars, philosophers and filmmakers, have devoted their energies to imagining life beyond this Earth. Their task has been to try reducing the gap between the new worlds uncovered by science and exploration and the fantastic, strange worlds of the imagination. Their huge contribution has been important, not only in the way that the fictional imagination has helped us visualize the unknown, but also for the way in which it has helped us define our place in a changing cosmos. Stories rule. In the rich evolution of the question of extraterrestrial life, science fiction has influenced issues and debates in science. And in turn, popular culture has been inspired by scientific discovery and invention. The history of the alien has hinted at the revolutionary effects on human science, society, and culture that knowledge of another civilization will bring. If we may be so bold as to suggest that humanity is at least one way in which the cosmos can know itself, what more is out there to be discovered? Arrival. How do humans compare with aliens? If aliens visit us, the outcome would be much as when Columbus landed in America, which didn't turn out well for the Native Americans. Stephen Hawking, The Guardian. Why should a vastly superior race bother to harm or destroy us? If an intelligent ant suddenly traced a message in the sand at my feet reading, "I am sentient, let's talk things over," I doubt very much that I would rush to grind him under my heel. Even if they weren't super intelligent, though, but merely more advanced than mankind, I would tend to lean more toward the benevolence, or at least indifference, theory. Since it's most unlikely that we would be visited from within our own solar system, any society capable of traversing light years of space would have to have an extremely high degree of control over matter and energy. Stanley Kubrick, Playboy. The division of intelligent life into two categories, natural and artificial, may eventually prove to be meaningless. We may anticipate the synthesis of body parts. Artificial intelligent beings of the future may be very long-lived. Their civilizations might be vastly longer-lived than civilizations like our own. Such civilizations could be very advantageous for interstellar contact among advanced communities and might be able to transmit the treasures of science and the heritage of culture of a dead civilization into the cosmos for hundreds of millions of years. Carl Sagan and I.S. Shklovsky, Intelligent Life in the Universe. Ian Donnelly, narrating. Why did they park where they did? The world's most decorated experts can't crack that one. The most plausible theory is that they chose places on Earth with the lowest incidence of lightning strikes. But there are exceptions. The next most plausible theory is that Sheena Easton had a hit song at each of these sites in 1980, so we just don't know. Eric Heiserer, Arrival. The Great Chain of Being. Among the questions raised by the 2016 science fiction movie Arrival is, where do humans stand in the cosmic scheme of things? In other words, how do we measure up against whatever extraterrestrial life might lie in wait beyond the Earth? This question has a considerable backstory. Just as the typical medieval town was walled in, so was the medieval universe, a walled-in cosmos, bounded between heaven and Earth, closed to the ravages of change and time. Continuity was key. It was a connected cosmos, emanating from the realm of the Godhead in those old days of faith, through the nested concentric spheres of crystalline perfection, which carried the planets on their courses, and down to the dark and lowly corruptible Earth at its center. This connected cosmos also included God's plan for all living things in the universe, and that plan was an ornate pageant of divine life known as the Great Chain of Being. On the chain sat a cornucopia of creation, an infinite procession of links stretching from God down to the lowliest form of life. This scale of being, or scala naturae, was a strict hierarchical system, ranging from the highest perfection of the unchanging spirit, who sat at the top of the chain, down to the fallibility of flesh at the core, mutable and corruptible man. It was a natural order of sorts. Elements that sat at the foot of the chain, such as rock, from which the earth is made, merely existed. Moving up the chain, each successive link enjoyed more positive attributes to those below. Plants then possessed life as well as existence. Animals enjoyed the additional qualities of motion and appetite. Every imaginable creature and object had a place in this great scheme of things, but each position was determined in a rather anthropocentric way, often according to its usefulness to man. Wild beasts were superior to domestic ones, since they resisted training. Useful creatures, such as horses and dogs, were better than docile ones, such as sheep. easily taught birds of prey were superior to lowlier birds such as pigeons. Edible fish were higher up the totem pole than more dubious and inedible sea creatures. Even aesthetics came into it. Attractive creatures such as dragonflies and ladybugs were considered worthier of God's glory than unpleasant insects such as flies and, no doubt, dung beetles. The poor snake languished at the very bottom of the animal segment, relegated as punishment for the serpent's alleged actions in the Garden of Eden. Some aspects of the chain persist in popular culture today. The lion is still considered the king of all creatures, the oak the king of all plants, the eagle king of the sky. It was not just unthinkable to abandon your place in the great continuous chain. It was impossible. This strict sense of permanence was crucial to the conception of the medieval world, and it was easy to see how this system became a useful means of control in feudal society. The great chain was used to justify the doctrine of the divine right of kings, the idea that the monarch was subject to no earthly authority. The chain had its reflection in this authoritarian social order that saw kings at the pinnacle, aristocratic lords below, and the great mass of peasants way down the societal scale. The king derived his right to rule directly from above and was not subject to the will of his people, the aristocracy, or any other estate of the realm, but to the will of God. The importance of the chain to early ideas of life in the universe is nicely summed up in the following quote, often referenced in texts of the Middle Ages, but written earlier by 5th century philosopher Macrobius, one of the last pagan writers of ancient Rome. "Since from the supreme God mind arises, and from mind soul, and since this in turn creates all subsequent things and fills them all with life, and since all things follow in continuous succession, degenerating in sequence to the very bottom of the series, the attentive observer will discover a connection of parts, from the supreme God down to the last dregs of things, mutually linked together and without a break. And this is Homer's golden chain, which God, he says, bade hang down from heaven to earth." And this is where medieval man found himself. Spiritually speaking, man was a special case in the chain. He was both mortal in flesh and potentially pure in spirit. The resolution of this struggle between his two aspects meant that he could either go the higher, noble way of the spirit or be dragged down to the devil, the way of all flesh, just as Lucifer himself had fallen. Kings of the Cosmos. Now, you're probably wondering at this point, what on earth has all this to do with the movie Arrival and the human relationship with aliens? The answer, in short, is everything. From the very early days of science fiction stories about alien life, the great chain of being became the backstory of choice. The question had clicked with Johannes Kepler, author of one of the very first science fiction stories, Insomnium, almost as soon as Galileo discovered our moon might be livable. And centuries later, when Darwin gifted science the principle of evolution, a principle that might reign in heaven as well as on Earth, science fiction was again alive to the question of how man might measure up. Using Darwin as his guide, H.G. Wells quoted Kepler at the very start of the War of the Worlds Martian invasion. "But who shall dwell in these worlds if they be inhabited? Are we or they lords of the world?" In other words, who's boss of the universe and king of the cosmos? Man had assumed his dominion over nature, but how would we fare in that great expanse beyond this earth? H.G. Wells had little doubt in the answer. Man wouldn't measure up at all. So Wells created the myth of a technologically superior extraterrestrial intelligence. The War of the Worlds features the men of the future in alien form. They are what we may one day become. They are the tyranny of intellect alone. And Imperial Britain, for once, is on the receiving end of interplanetary Darwinism. Look how brilliantly Wells frames the entire cosmic chain of being argument in one of the opening sections to The War of the Worlds. No one would have believed in the last years of the 19th century that this world was being watched keenly and closely by intelligences greater than man's, and yet as mortal as his own, that as men busied themselves about their various concerns, they were scrutinized and studied, perhaps almost as narrowly as a man with a microscope might scrutinize the transient creatures that swarm and multiply in a drop of water. With infinite complacency, men went to and fro over this globe about their little affairs, serene in their assurance of their empire over matter. It is possible that the infusoria under the microscope do the same. No one gave a thought to the older worlds of space as sources of human danger, or thought of them only to dismiss the idea of life upon them as impossible or improbable. It is curious to recall some of the mental habits of those departed days. At most, terrestrial men fancied there might be other men upon Mars, perhaps inferior to themselves and ready to welcome a missionary enterprise. Yet across the gulf of space, minds that are to our minds as ours are to those of the beasts that perish, intellects vast and cool and unsympathetic, regarded this earth with envious eyes, and slowly and surely drew their plans against us. And early in the 20th century came the Great Disillusionment. Wells destroys the idea that man is the pinnacle of evolution, though, spoiler, the Martians turned out to be as complacent as man. Earthly microbes eventually led to their downfall. After Wells, the topic of alien contact and man's place on the cosmic evolutionary ladder became a 20th century obsession. Science didn't even begin to come to terms with the potential shock of discovering an extraterrestrial intelligence until the 1960s, with Carl Sagan and I.S. Shklovsky's Intelligent Life in the Universe. But decades before that, science fiction writers like Olaf Stapledon and Arthur C. Clarke were preparing the public for the close encounters of alien contact. A close encounter of the first kind was a visual sighting of an unidentified flying object, apparently less than 500 feet away. A close encounter of the second kind was a UFO incident in which a physical effect occurs, such as electronic interference, paralysis, or discomfort in the witness, or impressions in the earth, such as scorched vegetation or a chemical trace. Science fiction was far more interested in encounters of the third and fourth kind. The third kind being an encounter where beings are present, whether they be humanoid or robotic pilots of the craft, and the fourth kind involving some kind of human abduction. This is where the movie Arrival comes into play. The Oscar-nominated blockbuster wondered what a message from a being with an entirely alien biology would look like. In a cosmic sense, humans are relatively newborn, and we've only been scanning our skies for alien craft or signals for the length of a human life. If a signal or craft is heading our way, it will likely be from a civilization that's at least a few hundred thousand years further evolved than us, higher up that great chain of being that science fiction has always been preparing us for. Would we really be able to understand what they had to say? It's likely that, even when the kings of the cosmos dumbed down their message, the secrets of what they had to say would remain a mystery. How did science fiction put men on the moon? For 7 days and seven nights we sailed the air, and on the eighth day we saw a great country in it, resembling an island, bright and round and shining with a great light. Running in there and anchoring, we went ashore, and on investigating found that the land was inhabited and cultivated. By day nothing was in sight from the place, but as night came on we began to see many other islands hard by, some larger, some smaller, and they were like fire in color. We also saw another country below, with cities in it and rivers and seas and forests and mountains. This we inferred to be our own world. Lucian, a true story. The surface of the moon is not perfectly smooth, free from inequalities and exactly spherical, as a large school of philosophers considers with regard to the moon and the other heavenly bodies, but that, on the contrary, it is full of irregularities. Uneven, full of hollows and protuberances, just like the surface of the earth itself, which is varied everywhere by lofty mountains and deep valleys. Galileo Galilei, the starry messenger. There will certainly be no lack of human pioneers when we have mastered the art of flight. Who would have thought that navigation across the vast ocean is less dangerous and quieter than in the narrow, threatening gulfs of the Adriatic, or the Baltic, or the British Straits? Let us create vessels and sails adjusted to the heavenly ether, and there will be plenty of people unafraid of the empty wastes. In the meantime, we shall prepare for the brave sky travelers, maps of the celestial bodies. I shall do it for the moon, you, Galileo, for Jupiter. Johannes Kepler, Conversation with the Starry Messenger. I foresaw very well that the vacuity would, to fill up the space, attract a great abundance of air, whereby my box would be carried up, and that, proportionable as I mounted, the rushing wind that should force it through the hole could not rise to the roof, but that furiously penetrating the machine, it must needs force it upon high. Cyrano de Bergerac, The States and Empires of the Moon. To answer this question, we could start with Italian astronomer Galileo Galilei. 400 years ago, Galileo famously wielded the newly invented telescope like a weapon of discovery. A new universe was unveiled, and the moon became a vital piece in a new cosmic puzzle. Galileo's revolutionary pamphlet, The Starry Messenger, told the tale of his discoveries with the telescope. Written in 1610, it urged the reader to imagine walking on the lunar mountains and craters, just like here on our home planet. It was the first time the moon became a real object for the great majority of people. Before Galileo, the moon, for many, was just a disk in the sky. But with the telescope, it became an object of wonder, and we began to contemplate the possibilities. Was there life on the moon? And how might humans one day walk those craggy craters? And yet, science fiction had already sent men to the moon. Years before Galileo wielded his spyglass, German math scholar Johannes Kepler had begun imagining journeys to Earth's natural satellite. Indeed, the word satellite was actually coined by Kepler. Kepler's book, Somnium, though published in 1634, had first germinated in Kepler's mind as early as 1593. It was one of the first fictional moon voyages with a strong scientific flavor, in which Kepler imagined an alien life fit for a lunar landscape. The scientific revolution itself began with Galileo's discoveries with the telescope. The countless stars and impure spots on an allegedly perfect sun, that could only be seen with the aid of a spyglass, were new evidence to the lie of the perfect and immutable heavens that old Aristotle claimed almost 2,000 years earlier. Still, it was mostly Galileo's discovery of other worlds that sparked a revolution. 4 entirely new worlds in the shape of the main moons in orbit around Jupiter, a focus of gravitation other than the Earth, and the discovery of a world in the moon with its terrestrial mountains and craters. Both Kepler and Galileo produced a map of the knowable, just as the unknown was at the point of becoming known. Galileo's starry messenger implied that Kepler's creatures may well be dwelling on the moon. It was a vital new piece of evidence in the debate on the existence of extraterrestrial life. Yes, it's the first time the moon became a real object for us. But at that same instant, we also felt a sense of wonder or estrangement from this new reality.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.